Hi, I'm Chrissy Kuiper, and I'm a board member of Discover Life in America. I want to welcome you to this virtual Firefly event presented by Discover Life in America in partnership with Firefly photographer Radim Schreiber. DLIA is a nonprofit that's all about understanding and protecting biological diversity. It's based in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park, and the nonprofit works with park staff as well as scientists and volunteers to conduct the All Taxa Biodiversity Inventory. The ATBI is aimed at cataloging every single species living in the Smokies. If we want to be good stewards of our environment and keep the world around us healthy and vibrant, especially now, we need to understand the web of biodiversity, because we can't protect species if we don't know that they exist. But the information that we need, what species live in an environment, what roles they play, how they interact with each other, is largely unknown. Since 1998, the ATBI has added over 9,500 new species records for the Smokies, over 1,000 new species that are new to science, and we now know of over 20,000 species in Great Smoky Mountains National Park alone, more than any other U.S. national park. The Smokies ATBI is also one of the longest-running and most comprehensive and most ambitious biodiversity projects ever undertaken, and it serves as a model for research and biodiversity studies around the world. As a new board member of Discover Life in America, I became involved because I grew up in these mountains of eastern Tennessee and western North Carolina. I love them. They are beautiful to me. They bring me peace. And it's so exciting to hear about all of the amazing species that are discovered all the time. Please consider supporting DLIA and its work in the Smokies. Click the link in the description below to find out how. Thank you, and enjoy the show.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Discover Life in America's virtual Firefly event. I'm Dr. Will Kuhn, Director of Science and Research here at Discover Life in America, and I'm excited to talk to you today about fireflies of the Smokies. Depending on where you live, fireflies are called fireflies or lightning bugs or sometimes glowworms, but they're all beetles in the beetle family Lempiridae. There are 170 species of fireflies known to North America, and 2,250 species known worldwide, but there are likely to be hundreds more species that are still undiscovered. Fireflies are beetles, and they go through complete metamorphosis, kind of like a butterfly. So they start off as an egg, and then a larva, and then a pupa, and then hatch out as an adult. And while the adult's what we think of as kind of the typical firefly, this organism actually spends most of its time as a larva, crawling around in the leaf litter looking for small invertebrates to eat. And firefly adults, males and females of some species, look the same, like this winged beetle. But in other species, the females can have short wings or even no wings at all and look like a grub. Many firefly species are protected by a chemical in their blood called lacibophagins. And this is a protective steroid that is distasteful and can gum up the mouthparts of arthropod predators, and also gives fireflies that kind of firefly smell if you've ever caught one. And because of this chemical protection, there are quite a number of species that mimic them. So on the left here, we have a firefly. And on the right, we have a number of other insects that mimic, that look like fireflies. So there's a number of beetle species, there's a cockroach, there's a couple of moths here. And this is just a small sample of the many species that mimic fireflies because of that protection. But fireflies do have predators, and these consist of other arthropods, things like spiders and harvestmen and other insects. And firefly predators can include other fireflies. Some species of Photurus fireflies, the females are able to mimic the flash patterns of a number of other protected firefly species, lure those males in, and eat them. And these females are thought to be unprotected by this chemical, but by eating protected males, they actually gain that protection. Fireflies are best known for their bioluminescence, meaning that they produce light through a biological process. They have these special cells called photocytes in their lanterns, and these photocytes contain a number of chemicals that work together with oxygen to produce light. And this reaction is almost 100% efficient, meaning that it produces almost 100% light and almost no heat. And you may be wondering, why do fireflies bioluminesce in the first place? Well, so not only do the adults of fireflies light up, but so do larvae of most species, and in some species even the egg and the pupal stage produce light. It's likely that the larvae use their light for visual orientation, and also to warn predators that if they see something that glows, you don't want to eat it because it probably tastes bad. So adults probably also warn predators like this. As we've seen in some firefly species, they can attract food in using their light, but perhaps the most important use is for mate recognition. So firefly males flash to females, and then the females flash back, and this is a back and forth kind of dance that allows them to find each other and mate. And these flash patterns are species specific, meaning that each kind of firefly makes a different flash pattern. And the flash patterns can be very simple, just a single flash every few seconds, or they can be a little bit more complicated where you have multiple flashes followed by periods of darkness and then more flashes. Or in other species, the male turns on his light and then moves or streaks across the sky and produces this kind of characteristic, another characteristic pattern. In the Smokies, there are 19 species of fireflies known. Six of those are diurnal, meaning that they come out, they're active during the day and don't produce light. Three species are crepuscular, meaning that they're most active at dusk and dawn. And nine species are nocturnal, meaning that they come out at night in full darkness. Here's some examples of the diurnal species that don't produce light. So instead of light, they use chemicals to find each other. Females will put out pheromones, and males use their large antennae to smell out those pheromones and find the females. Perhaps the most well-known firefly species in eastern North America is the J-stroke or Big Dipper firefly. This species is active throughout the summer in open fields, roadways, and even manicured lawns, particularly at dusk. And this species is called the J-stroke because the male turns on his light and then flies upward and over, creating this kind of J-shaped streak across the sky. My favorite firefly species in Appalachia is the blue ghost firefly. So this species has kind of two peaks, one in late spring and one in early summer. It's fully nocturnal, so it comes out late at night. And its males turn on their light, and kind of uncharacteristically compared to other fireflies, they leave it on and just sort of streak across the vegetation looking for females. And something else that's really interesting about this species is, so we have a male here on the left that's winged, but the female is larvae form. She never grows wings. This is a female shown here on the right. The star of the firefly show in the Smokies is the synchronous firefly. This species prefers kind of higher elevations above 1400 feet. It likes a certain habitat called an open cove hardwood forest. And it comes out late at night during a short period of time between late May and mid-June. And it has a very characteristic flash pattern where the males have a quick succession of flashes, 5 to 8 flashes, flash, 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 followed by about a 6 second period of darkness, and then another series of flashes and more darkness. And the synchronicity in this species is not in the flashes. The flashes never really synchronize exactly, but they all flash randomly and then they all stop at the same time, and there's darkness, and then they all start flashing at the same time. And by having this little period of darkness in between the male flashes, that allows for the females to flash back to certain males that they think have an especially sexy flash. And so this is thought to be an adaptation. This synchronicity is thought to be an adaptation to this kind of crowding that happens when you have thousands of individuals out in one place just for a short period of time. And these flash patterns are actually recognizable even in photographs. So here we have all these yellow splotches that are the synchronous fireflies, the flash trains of their males. And then the green kind of streaks are the blue ghost males producing their long, streaky, snaking lines. Something that I find so interesting about fireflies is that they are so well known. Everybody knows what a firefly is, this insect that lights up at night. And yet there's so much that we don't know about them. We don't know a lot about their natural history of many species. We don't know where they're going or what they're doing when they're not flashing. And we don't even know how many species there are. There's still so many more species to be discovered. So fireflies have kind of three basic needs in order to really thrive. They need to have a sheltered habitat, kind of undisturbed vegetation that provides sort of higher humidity where they can run around in the leaf litter and look for their food. And they need to have food, and that can consist of snails and worms and other insects. And the food has to have adequate habitat as well. And then finally, the flashing species of fireflies need really good darkness. When you have a lot of artificial light, that really disrupts this sort of dance between the males and the females. They can't really see each other, and then they can't find each other. There's a few things that you can do to help fireflies in your area. You can leave undisturbed habitat. If you have a yard, you can leave unmowed patches, you can plant native plants, and reduce the use of pesticides and herbicides. You can also reduce outdoor lighting. So, as I said, artificial light messes with fireflies' ability to find each other, and so the longer periods of darkness they have, the better they're going to do. And lastly, you can advocate for green spaces in your neighborhood, in your community. And these parks and wildlife refuges not only will help fireflies, but they also help pollinators, birds, bees, and lots of other things as well. Special shout out to Redeem Schreiber for putting together this video and for letting us use his amazing firefly photography. And also to Abbott Nature Photography for letting us use their firefly photos as well. So here are some references used in this presentation and some great resources on the right for learning more about fireflies in your area. If you'd like this presentation and you want to find out more about our organization, look us up at dlia.org and also on social media. And if you want to support our mission in Great Smoky Mountains National Park, please consider donating. There's a link in the description below. Now relax and enjoy the firefly experience.